Since their debut as enemies in Splatoon 1's story mode, people have wanted to play as Octolings. In the first game, Inklings were the only playable species, so this was only possible through hacking. In Splatoon 2, playable Octolings were added as a purely cosmetic reward for beating the Octo Expansion DLC, meaning they were essentially locked behind a paywall and a little bit of a skill wall for some players. Splatoon 3 is the first game in the series where both options are available right off the bat. The only thing stopping someone from playing as an Octoling is their own personal preference. So that begs the question, do more players play as Inklings or Octolings? And by how much? Hi, I'm ScribbleSpecters, and I spent the chill season documenting every Inkling and Octoling I encountered to answer this very question. I did this because I like Splatoon a normal amount. Today, we're going to be taking a look at what goes into conducting a survey like this, and seeing what we can glean from the resulting data. Without further ado, let's go ahead and get started with... If you played a 4v4 turf war match and counted up the number of Inklings and Octolings present, would that group be an accurate reflection of the entire player base? Probably not. Well, what if you walked around Splatsville and tallied up everyone there? That's probably not enough either. These are the dangers of conducting a survey with a sample size that's too small. It leads to a wider margin of error. So then, how many players should we survey? If we wanted 100% accuracy, we'd have to assess every Splatoon 3 player on Earth, which is impossible. Real-life survey conductors know this, and use mathematical formulas to find a sample size that's a good compromise between accuracy and research costs. There are two main formulas for this, one for finding percentages and one for finding averages. Since we're trying to figure out what percentage of players are Inklings or Octolings, we'll be using the first one. I'll try to keep the math quick and painless. I thought about skipping it, but I didn't want to look like I was pulling numbers out of thin air. You're welcome to skip it if you want, though. I promise it won't hurt my feelings. So in this formula, n is our minimum required sample size, what we're trying to solve for. We also have p, which is the estimate of population proportion. Normally, the number we set p to would be based on pre-existing data, but since we don't have any, we'll be leaving it at the default value of 0.5. This is because it's a pretty safe starting point to guess that 50% of players are Octolings. We also have Z and E, which are the standard error and acceptable margin of error for our chosen confidence level. And this is the important part. When big official businesses prepare to conduct surveys, they'll set a desired confidence level for it. For example, a commonly used one is 95% confidence with a plus or minus 5% margin of error. What does that mean? Imagine a researcher handing you their survey results and saying, "We are 95% confident that the real answer is within plus or minus 5% of the answer our survey produced." That's basically what it means. There are two conventional setups for this, the first being the one I already said, 95% confidence with a plus or minus 5% margin of error. The other one, 99% confidence with a plus or minus 1% margin of error, has higher accuracy, but is usually reserved for big, important business decisions because it's very costly. So we're going to be sticking with the first one, and after plugging in our values, we're given a minimum required sample size of 385 players. Now, a good survey conductor doesn't include themselves in the sample, so I won't be counting myself. That means every 8-player match I get into provides 7 players for the sample, as long as I enter an entirely new lobby every single time. That divides out nicely to 55 matches. A Salmon Run would only give 3 players, so that rounds up to 129 matches for that mode. I honestly couldn't decide how to divvy up the matches between modes, so I just ended up doing a full sample for each. In the end, this created a total sample size of 1,542 players. And with a sample size that big, we've actually managed to cut our margin of error in half. Hooray! Yippee! Woohoo! Now that I knew how many players I'd need to survey, I created a calendar noting how many matches I'd need to play each day to get through all of them before chill season ended. So my dailies consisted of playing the allotted number of matches for the day, looking at the records for those matches on the Splatnet 3 app, and entering that data into a spreadsheet. This included the date, stage, and mode each player was encountered on, as well as their username and species, as indicated by the symbols on the right. You'll notice that usernames are blurred in this video and not included in the document shared in the description. Obviously, I have no way of asking these people if they're okay with having their usernames publicized like this, so I figured this was the way to go. It's probably for the best. I mean, a handful of them were not family-friendly. I guess that's online games for ya. I also wrote down weapon data, but I realize now that it's pretty useless. Not only because chill season's over and new weapons have been added, but also mid-range support weapons are heavily under-repped because that's what I was using and I wasn't counting myself. With all that established, let's start breaking things down by mode, and at the end we'll combine it all together for the overall results. In theory, Turf War should be the simplest mode to record data for, but there was one little hiccup that I had to consider. By the time I'd completed 55 matches, I realized that 39 of them were during Splatfests. Why is this a potential issue? During Splatfests, a team can be awarded synergy bonuses, one of which is for all team members being the same species. Now I doubt Splatfest matchmaking would purposefully try to pair me with other Octolings to make this happen, but I ended up making separate samples anyway, just for comparison's sake. Here's what they amounted to. Of the 385 regular Turf War players, 176 were Inklings, and 209 were Octolings, giving them a 54.29% majority. Of the 385 Splatfest players, 168 were Inklings, and 217 were Octolings, giving them a 56.36% majority. So Splatfest did end up having a higher percentage of Octolings, but seeing as I never got the synergy bonus I mentioned, this is most likely just coincidence. Okay, I feel the Anarchy Battle sample is one that I need to put a couple disclaimers for. The first is that, since I conducted this survey solo, players in this sample are going to be limited to my rank at the time. Honestly, this shouldn't have any real effect on the survey results. A player's species is determined long before they're assigned a rank, so causality between the two seems unlikely. Of course, without samples for the other ranks, I have no way of proving or disproving this. It'd be pretty crazy if there was a noticeable demographic shift as you ascended the ranks, though. The other big disclaimer is that I don't play Clam Blitz. Like, at all. Tried a couple rounds when I first got the game, and it just wasn't for me. I'm sure it's more fun with, like, coordinated teams, but I haven't touched it since, and I feel like if I tried it now, I'd just get my face bashed in. So if there's, like, a disproportionately large cluster of Inklings hiding out in Clam Blitz or something, then I'm sorry I missed ya. But again, the idea that a player's species is in any way tied to their favorite mode seems highly unlikely. Okay, with those disclaimers out of the way, here are the Anarchy results. Of the 385 Anarchy players sampled, 160 were Inklings, and 225 were Octolings, giving them a 58.44% majority. That's the highest yet. There wasn't actually a bunch of Inklings hiding out in Clam Blitz, right? Salmon Run is probably the mode I play the most normally, so I didn't mind having to play 129 rounds of it here. Due to the difference in lobby size, this sample has two more players than the others, but this isn't enough to have any significant impact on accuracy, so don't get your hopes up. I guess I could put the same disclaimer about rank here too. So this sample is mostly going to consist of Executive VP players, with a sprinkling of Professional plus 3 if I was having a rough shift. Other than that, the sampling process was pretty straightforward for this one. There isn't a whole lot to report. I mean, I did notice that Salmon Run's results screens don't have accurate species symbols compared to other modes in the app, but I think that was patched in Fresh Season, so instead of lingering on it, let's just get to the numbers. Of the 387 Salmon Run players sampled, 185 were Inklings, and 202 were Octolings, giving them a 52.2% majority. These were the most even results yet, and with our margin of error, it's entirely possible that I could have gotten an Inkling majority if I took another sample. So for all the corrupt stuff Grizzco does, at least we know discriminatory hiring isn't one of them. Alright, we've covered four individual samples of 385-ish players each. Now it's time to squish them all together for the final result. Of the 1,542 total players sampled, 689 were Inklings, and 853 were Octolings, giving them a 55.32% majority. Remember that this biggest sample size comes with a reduced margin of error of about plus or minus 2.5%. That means in reality, Octolings could actually make up anywhere from 52.8% to 57.8% of the entire player base. So while the exact proportions are still up in the air, a slight Octoling majority seems all but confirmed at this point. To learn a bit more about why this is the case, I set up a YouTube poll to gather more information. The poll results actually ended up being even more lopsided, but keep in mind that YouTube polls are definitely not a reliable survey method, at least for this research case. This is because they're considered convenience samples. A convenience sample occurs when the people selected for it were only surveyed because they were easy to reach. As a result, they don't accurately represent the population we're trying to assess. Also, if a YouTube poll was all that was needed, do you think I would have gone through all this trouble? Come on now. But that's okay, because what I was really after with this poll were the comments people left explaining their preferences. I already had some guesses on the reasons people might give, and most of them were brought up in some capacity. I'll try to summarize them as best I can. Inkling players like that they have more customization options. Their masks and pointy ears give a less human appearance, which is cool. Longtime players see them as iconic, comfortable, and nostalgic. On more than one occasion, veteran players who never got Octo Expansion remember feeling envious at the time, but since then have become so committed to being an Inkling that they didn't switch over when given the chance. On the flip side, Octoling players don't mind having less customization options, as long as the ones they do have are stylish. Multiple people said they feel Octolings are cuter, but unlike Inkling fans, they didn't really go into specifics. Voices were also mentioned, with someone saying they prefer
female
over
female.
It was also pointed out that there probably are players out there who did switch because it's free now, and while no first-person accounts of this were given, I'd say that's a pretty reasonable assumption to make. Personally, I was surprised that no one gave lore as a reason to get attached to Octolings, because it's certainly one for me. One person described Inklings and Octolings as being like Mario and Luigi, respectively, and I feel like that's relevant here. Like, yes, Inklings are the face of the franchise, and have been from the start, but Octolings not being that has given them more opportunities for interesting history, characterization, and personality, which I find endearing. A lot of this comes from Splatoon 2's Octo Expansion, so Splatsville's Octolings may or may not share that backstory, but the association is still there, I think. There were also some reasons I saw being given for both sides. These included things like picking whatever option resembled the player most in real life, to making the exact same choices they did in previous games to create a sense of continuity. And to cap things off, the poll also revealed something that my experiment could not. My research methods could only record a player's species in the moment, but apparently there's a sizable part of the fanbase that regularly switches between the two. It's pretty normal to see someone treat their player character as an OC of sorts, but this idea of making more than one and having them bounce off each other was a delightful little discovery for me. I personally can't see myself playing the game this way, but I think it's really sweet that there are players out there who enjoy Inklings and Octolings enough to make time for both. It's definitely better than pitting them against each other, at least. In a way, it kind of shows how far things have come since the first game, that this coexistence we once could only dream of is now so commonplace. But maybe I'm just being sappy over here. This has been ScribbleSpecters, and thank you very much for watching. If you enjoyed this video, consider checking out my Ko-fi page. That's where you can support the channel with one-time or monthly donations. And if my commissions are open, you can even have me draw you something. So if that interests you, I hope you'll give it a look. And if not, don't sweat it. There are lots of other ways you can support the channel too, like sharing your thoughts in the comments. Were you surprised by the research results? Do you have a different reason for why you play as an Inkling or Octoling? I love hearing what y'all have to say. I've never had to do an outro before. How am I supposed to...